Very warm welcome to the International Film Festival Rotterdam. Very welcome audience, great you're here. We have some very distinguished guests to discuss the state of Europe. That's going. We're going to discuss in the coming, let's see, half an hour, maybe 45 minutes, maybe an hour. Let's see how far we can take it. Maybe you noticed the state of Europe is one of the focus points this year at the festival, and we're going to explore this question of what happens if you put the question, the state of Europe, in the heart of the festival. What can we learn from it? Which questions do arise, and what happens from there? I will first introduce the guests, and then we'll kick off and we'll see where we go from there. To my far right, for you, to your far left, Thomas Bellink, a theatre maker. From Belgium, and he's here present at the festival with the House of European History and Exile, a really marvelous exhibition. If you haven't seen it yet, go there today or tomorrow later on. Well, today's too late, but it closes at 5. But tomorrow, please go there before in Brussels and now being shown in Rotterdam. Very nice you're here. Next to him, Xiaolu Go. Well, welcome. Originally from China, now lives in London, and she can do everything: scriptwriter, director, novelist, poetry, journalist. And she's here with a really beautiful film, Late at Night, Voices of Ordinary Madness. Great year, thank you. Next to her, the film director of the film festival, Rutger Wolfson. And last but not least, Iva Radivojevic. Oh, I kind of
mentioned. I'll take it.
One of the 25 new faces of independent film of 2013, according to the Filmmaker magazine, and she's here also with a really marvelous film, Evaporating Borders. Great year. Also in the audience, we have the three programmers of the festival responsible for the State of Europe program. Great year, Yevgeny, Gerwin, and Gerjan. Hopefully also, if you feel like participating in the debate, but also the other members of the audience, please do so during this debate. Let's kick off. The State of Europe, Rutger, because you're guilty. We're sitting here because you thought it was really important to question yourself, what can a film festival do within the European discourse? Could you explain very shortly why we're sitting here discussing the State of Europe during an international film festival?
Well, Europe is possibly the most unsexy subject matter you can imagine. Everybody's complaining about Europe. People are disillusioned with the European project, they are bored with it, at the same time it's not like that there's a lot of room for new ideas about Europe. You see very very evidently with the elections for the European Parliament coming up that
in May
that politicians seem almost unable to generate new future visions for Europe. And that's, I guess, part of the problem. Historically, the reasons for creating Europe has been no more war or economic prosperity. These two points are still valid, but they're not inspiring us anymore. Mm-hmm. So my idea was if the politicians are not able to generate any new ideas, perhaps the culture arena can. Perhaps film can.
Yep.
And of course, if you look at the history of European film after the Second World War, it's very clear that there have been many films, many filmmakers that people have were inspired by or touched by or moved by, even though, for example, you'd be a Dutch audience member and it would be an Italian film. Still, you would be very much moved by these films. So clearly, film has this power to touch us in that way.
Mm-hmm.
So I became very curious, can we look again at film and starting from film generate new ideas about Europe, which is hopelessly ambitious, of course, but that's what
okay, well, it's really good nice. To be an overachiever and to look for ambition. Let's later on discuss if we found new ideas and what kind of themes we found also within the films being shown during the festival. Maybe also the programmers want to say something about later on. But first, this idea of putting this narrative, looking for a European narrative in a festival. Thomas, did it when you were approached by Rutger to have your exhibition, and he was telling you probably also this story about I'm looking for these ideas, and you thought, why the hell would I do this at a festival? Or does it completely make sense for you?
Well, it did really make sense in the way that I'd built my exhibition, which is really about. So it's an exhibition, for those who haven't seen it, it's an exhibition that from the future looks back on today as if it were history. And it's all about the European project. So it really made sense in the way that the theme was very much interrelated. And also the reason why I built it is very, very much linked with this idea that a lot of people have lost faith in the European project. And are really these days really tempted to throw it all away, to throw in the towel, and throwing away everything that, I mean, goes along with it.
Yeah.
Even if it's positive things. So that was very much interrelated to me. So I immediately said yes. That was clear.
Okay, so for you it was spot on to use a festival or use this way of thinking. This approach to Europe was very logical. This is a very logical place to generate ideas or to ask these questions.
Yeah, I think that goes. I mean, you can't force filmmakers to or artists to now start creating things about Europe
No.
or anything. I don't think it's necessarily about being a strictly unidirectional. I don't know, movie or project about about European politics or something.
Yeah.
But I think
there are political systems who do that, but that's a different.
Yeah, thing. Definitely. Maybe you can tell us more about that. But yeah, to me it makes sense. I don't think a festival should like have Europe as a theme this year and then move on to Latin America next year or something. But it's more about being. I mean, I don't think it goes for everybody, but as an artist, you usually try to work within the moment and create something about not necessarily really political on a very flat level, but you try to work within the reality that you experience and you live and that shocks you or frustrates you or pisses you off. And clearly, if you live in Europe these days, there's a lot of things going on and going wrong, so it's not hard to end up within this scope of the European project as a
Xialu, how is that for you? What is it for you when you heard of the festival and now did you hear? What is your take on putting this core question?
Because I'm automatically a storyteller as a writer and as a filmmaker. Although first I'm an immigrant from China, so I've been living in Europe for 12 years. First in Germany, actually in Hamburg and Berlin for about 2 years. And then I moved to London, so London for 10 years, and then a bit of Paris for some residence. But my film here presenting is really about this largest European city. If we count London as a European city, it's the largest European city with 8.5 million people, kind of crowded in this tiny space in East London because the cheapest area in London. Mm-hmm. All the immigrants from North Africa, from South Africa, from Asian, and from Middle East, and kind of their daily misery in very expensive London, which is still very occupied by the class system. Mm-hmm. And I think the film is kind of very fragmented collective portrait of all these underclass people. Really kind of a madness in this kind of institutional madhouse, which is, let's again, okay, mention those words, which I don't want to mention those words, capitalism, globalization, because I often think those words are being abused, overused whenever there's intellectual discussion about globalization or capitalism. But again, those characters in my film are so much about how they've been suffered in that kind of asylum space. Mm-hmm. But once again, I think as an immigrant living in Europe, now for me, I write in my second language, which is English.
Yeah.
And I used to write Chinese. And now my film, my last two films are based in Europe. In a way, Europe is the biggest narrative in the whole world. Because it's not singular narrative. China is a singular narrative. Mm-hmm. Yeah, mm-hmm. It's always enclosed. The land not allowed immigration at all. And America, in a way, now closing the whole immigration thing. You know, in America, you can do investment immigration. But in Europe, is all the coast, the geography is basically the open door, the first land for immigration, illegal immigration. And I think the geography provides such a complexity for the whole very kind of complicated immigration history, but also the colonial past, the empire, the colonial history, I think brought about the cultural familiarity for other people, for other land. Mm-hmm. It's easier, in a way, for other countries to come to Europe because the whole colonial history. And for example, Britain, the biggest English empire brought up so many Indian, Bangladeshi, Chinese, or Africans, and I think creates, in a way, the London is one of the most interesting places in the whole world because so full of this kind of problem But on the other hand, I think when we talk about Europe, we're basically talking about the whole world. Is Europe is the most confrontational land receiving the whole world at the moment.
Okay, so it's interesting. So you see it's actually a continuing narrative which is still open for new directions.
Absolutely.
Where other...
And I think it's the beginning of the new Europe because people like us, now we're moving home here and we make narrative here. See, the personal narrative and there's a fictional narrative here, which is basically renewing the blood. For me, it's the most actually dynamic land in a way. You know, Europe is most dynamic for me. And and I want to hear what other people to think.
We'll continue then. Eva, what is your take on putting the State of Europe program such at the heart of a film festival like this and your maybe also your first personal take on being part of it?
So I think my film fits so perfectly because it was, I think the section is called EU 29 and it talks about films or people that are outside of the, you know, European Union.
Yeah, so and we created the new states, the 29 states where
And the film, so the film also, you know, talks about these people that are coming from, you know, Arab world or whatever. But I come from Europe, but I've been living in the States for so long that I come from a country that no longer exists, from Yugoslavia, right? And we have a very mixed family that I can't necessarily choose which identity I can pick. I grew up in Cyprus, and then I migrated to the United States, but my films are also very European. But what I think is really what you're saying, what's really interesting is that there is this opportunity now for a pluriversal world, right? Because we still hold on to this identity that we have of who I am according to my culture, my tradition, and so on. And we feel under attack by this new mixture of things. But I think it's more of an opportunity than anything else to be something more, like you said, something new. And I really welcome the program because we were talking before how I am impressed and I'm inspired because, you know, it's daring, it's creative, and there's so many unique voices and they all kind of blend together. Like I'm watching Sacro Gra, for example, and it's such a beautiful representation of what this new Europe is, right? And I'm seeing things that I wasn't even aware were there. So I think it's a really great way to open a conversation for what this new thing is going to look like. So thank you. That's good job.
You're welcome.
So when you listen to the three responses, Rutger, is this something what strikes you most if you hear the first take on two people filmmakers part of the program, also Thomas with his exhibition. If you hear their first responses, like it's a very dynamic narrative. Some people feel part of it, or feel excluded, or are trying to be part of this European narrative.
Many people in Europe have a kind of an inferiority complex because they are worried that new economies or new parts of the world will take over Europe and render Europe insignificant, will make it a large open-air museum.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
The only quality that Europe has are these old cultural values, but there will be nothing in the new economical reality. And then hearing you say, Europe's actually the place to be, it's the theater of the new world, it has all these conflicts that are the most interesting conflicts and the conflicts that will mean most for us in our future. That's as a European, that's an interesting thing to hear from China.
Only one thing, because I lived in China most of my life, 30 years I lived in China, and then moved here. Actually, I never heard this IMF thing when I was living in China. I didn't know what is it. So when I came here, so I keep hearing everything. IMF decided, you know, the voting agency, the rating agency decided to give up Ireland or Greece.
Yeah. With their ratings.
First question, what is that? Why some American power decide a little country in Europe what they're supposed to do? Mm-hmm. And I really didn't know when I was living in China. And I was, in a way, very naively furious, like, why should the IMF decide a country in Europe? And in a way, I think it's so sad and absurd. Nowadays, it's pure cooperation, international economy power control the state power. There's no longer state power. So any president in Europe or prime minister has no power. They will be depowered if they don't collaborate with IMF, with a whole international cooperation system. They will be depowered. And I think how to empower those independent power, say if we still believe in state power, say nation state, I don't know if I believe in that at all.
No.
But if if we need some kind of powerful government to do something, we must find solution to against this IMF system. Mm-hmm. But this is naive talk from filmmaker, you know, from some kind of non-really politically aware, you know, the situation like me. But mm-hmm. this is, I think, it's big problem in the financing world. How everyone's life is controlled by that system. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Yeah.
But it's interesting, yeah? But when it's all about taking care of your own life, about being in charge of your own life, yeah? You mentioned identity, but you also said it in about your film. It's interesting where this Europe or the nation state is becoming this arena, and we have this belonging to who are we? Yeah? You see it in your film in East London, where people who are dispossessed still want to be part of something. Well, you have all these layers of how do you approach it in your exhibition, or your approach where this identity question, which you see very strongly also in some of the films during the festival. Is that?
I think in the museum it's more about consciousness or awareness of how the machine functions.
Yep.
Because while I was researching it, I got the impression that actually, or I didn't even get the impression, it's basically reality, but that people have gradually lost control.
Yeah.
Not of the machine, but of how it functions. We no longer know how this Europe functions. We no longer know how this relationship with the IMF came about, where it comes from, why it was constructed in the first place. We no longer know what the European institutions are. I mean, ask anybody. In any case, the EU is very bad, or has very, very bad, what do you call it?
Reputation.
Communication management when it comes to just naming institutions. I mean, we've mm-hmm. got the European Council, then we've got the Council of the European Union, and then we've got the Council of Europe, which has nothing to do with the European Union
separate,
as such.
Separate,
so yeah. This is already where people get lost. So nobody no longer knows how it functions. So to me, it was also, I mean, I didn't want to create this kind of pedagogical exhibition or anything, but I mean, on a certain level it is, because it's all about regaining awareness of how the machine works so we can at least start working with it again and trying to change its course.
You?
No, I was just going to say this is really interesting and important way to kind of think about it, but I think it's also important to think about how our own kind of psychological machine works, right? In this kind of schizophrenic identity. Like, who are we? How do we identify? Mm. How do we approach the other person mm-hmm. through this kind of views that we have built up? So I think both work, you know, simultaneously.
Yeah, yeah. And even that was funny, because if you extrapolate it, in your fast forwards, we have 33 members of the European Union, so it's almost explodes to a Babylonian impossible way of communicating. So it becomes increasingly hard to belong to, right?
Yeah, or I don't know. It becomes increasingly hard to believe you belong to it. I think that's a different thing from being hard to belong to it, because I don't think it's very hard to belong to it. Hmm. I think it's more about believing in the fact the plane is flying.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, it does fly, but you have to believe it's flying, otherwise it crashes, and that's what's happening right now, I think, is that we no longer believe in a plane that can actually fly, but we think it can't.
Isn't it also within your film and the themes?
I think, I'm kind of conflicting with two things. One is I'm very dubious about the concept of identity, because I often extremely doubtful with the idea of identity, you know, what I'm supposed to be. If I'm a Muslim woman, okay, do I wear a scarf, go with a Muslim-style marriage? If I'm something else in certain religions, so lots of identities are created to basically suppress the freedom. And I think especially the identity within nationality, within the religious society is awfully poisoning and depressing.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But then we, as a human being, we have to possess or using identity to achieve the quality of life to be able to function in the society. Without identity, we are naked, we are nothing. We have become existential naked self in a Jean-Paul Sartre's novel, which is kind of hanging in the air like a surrealist painting, you know. So this identity is very dubious and hateful result of the man-made power society to control individual. So I'm very against it in a way. Yeah. So at the same time, I say, okay, can we promote a new word called transnationality? Mm-hmm. Yeah. I could have two or three passports. I could have different citizenship. Mm-hmm. I want to live beyond this. I want to speak more than one or two languages. So that's, in my personal life, I aim that.
But it's interesting.
Now, and come to emotional.
Yeah.
Emotional life, which we have this sensitivity or say even even sentimentality. The person wants to belong. So those characters in my film Later the Night is absolutely lost.
Yeah.
Because they left the home and they're street people. Most of the people are street people in my film. So the sense of belonging has become absolutely gone.
Yeah.
So I think the losing identity is it will be the continued future.
And do you think so? Because if Rutger formulated for himself his task or the idea of can all arts and culture still make a connection, for instance, Europe. So could there be in your transnational idea? Is this not maybe where your work or others' work?
Well, only if culture has power. I think it's wonderful Gajan Gewen curated these sections this year, and I think suddenly there's a reality in the film festival rather than celebrating of this porno production quality of fiction filmmaking, which I really detest. And I think it's wonderful there's a reality in this festival.
Yeah.
And I always love this festival, really. Not for any other purpose I speak like that. Because it's suddenly it's reality, and I think those documentary films with fiction elements in these sections are really quite interesting.
Yeah. Okay.
But if ever culture has power, because culture always a decoration of a certain kind of mainstream power, and I hope our discussion lands somewhere basically with some institution. Because they would do something with certain policies.
The point for us, I think, was to try and see if culture could be more influential and have a stronger voice in trying to figure out our own future instead of leaving it to politicians. I think that was really the core idea. Because, and you have to say that a lot of intellectuals or a lot of artists are so fed up with the idea of Europe that they don't even want to debate it. So
you found us.
You were the only guys who wanted to talk about it. No, but the idea was the idea is clearly that there are so many filmmakers who make films that stand in their own right. There are works of art in their own right, but there's a dimension in their work that speak about all these subjects that have to do with Europe. And then I think what we can do as a festival, as a cultural event, is to bring them together and allow audiences to see these films in their own right, but then on top of that, perhaps see them also through this perspective of this theme of Europe.
Yeah.
And I think that can be quite powerful, and that could be also like a safer place or a more friendly and open place for people to engage with the subject than just sort of like talking back to politics. I mean, to politicians. I mean, when do you ever talk to a politician and when is it ever an interesting conversation and how do you ever get access? So it's, I guess it's the idea that we try to, recover a little bit something of the debate and put it more towards ourselves, us normal people, citizens, to try and have this debate again. I think it was Geert Mak, I think, who had this quote where he said Appingedam or something needs Brussels, but Brussels needs Appingedam also.
Yeah.
And this is this has gotten completely lost, I think, in the whole dynamics.
Yep.
So this is a coup.
Now we're talking revolution time.
Yes.
Eva, could you also elaborate a bit on what Rutger said, but also Xielo, when it comes to this identity, this transnational way of thinking? Because it's very interesting also, some people you portrayed in your film are, well, I wouldn't call them transnationalists, they're quite opposite, right? I mean, there's some nationalist components there. Could you, something in your
Odyssey? I was thinking about what you just said, and I think it is so important to try to disidentify from this ingrained identity we have. So who am I when I, you know, kind of say I'm not this person? You know, who can I be in that different space? And yeah, I mean, in my film, we have the neo-Nazis who are very much holding on to this identity of who they are, right? And like you said, you know...
And they go way back.
They go way back, and here they are again, you know, dispersing up everywhere in Bulgaria, in Cyprus, in Greece. The question is, when you say once I let go of this identity, I'm this, you know, floating thing, and that's the scary place for them.
Absolutely.
Because you're facing death, right?
Yeah.
And that's what we're scared of. We're scared of death. So this is where the problem comes in, right? But I think it's so important to try to just let go of it and exist in a different kind of... and which is why, the program itself, I feel something must break, right? Which is in the competition, and also, you know, Jackie in the Kingdom of Women. Everything is questioning this identity in different ways, right? Not in a neo-Nazi way, but I think this you just touched upon that, which
I
is
guess
really, really important.
Like films like Claire Simon's Gardenaud, and I think so important in a way, because a public space like Gardenaud has no history, and everything's artificial, functional, and then suddenly, those characters from a very solid kind of cultural background meet there and have a very temporary relationship, which also can be quite deep and sorrowful. And I think that's the contemporary world. It's such a great example in a narrative format where we are living. We share this kind of functional public space, try to build our own history in those space, yeah, in human space and in different space. But again, it's so unlivable when when a person lives in a functional space, like this kind of hall, or if we live in an airport like life without any village past or continuation of the family. But this is our only future, actually. It's utopia to talk about a return to the nature, because there's no more nature. We have basically killed, destroyed the whole nature. So the only future is our urban future with certain kind of transnationality as the texture of our human relation. So that's the only future we're aiming. In that case, we should forget about return to the roots, all this kind of very nationalistic discussion, especially in certain big countries, which you know what I mean.
I think
we must face, that's our only future. And in that sense, I think Europe is really a front line for this discussion, because you're receiving the most confrontational case every day. Yeah.
Frontline coup, we're getting there. Thomas, let's go to the space concept, because what's interesting also about when it comes to your exhibition, I mean, you go there on your own or maybe with somebody else, but it's very, very personal. This is also a layer which I hear also from the other guests, that this is an important relationship between you and a system or you within European context, no?
Yeah, I did it for several reasons, because, of course, firstly, I it's just a dramaturgical reason where I want you to be completely on your own in this kind of empty, derelict building where I wanted the experience to be physical. I didn't want it to be intellectual, but I wanted this idea of a collapsed Europe to become something physical as well, where you walk around in this dusty, crummy museum and you feel what it might be like in 50 years' time when everybody's forgotten about the project. So in a first way, it's more about a physical experience. I think that was the first reason why I did it. But of course, I mean, while going through it on your own, of course, immediately that was the second reason. To me, the moments in my life where I was most confronted with history, for example, I was always on my own, and it was always a direct relationship I had with a place, with a person inhabiting a space. That were the moments in my life where history was really passed over from one person to another. Because I think history shouldn't be this abstract kind of thing they teach you in school, but it's a very much alive thing that changes all the time, and it's passed from person to person often. That's the reason why I wanted you to go through it alone and to meet me, because I'm present in the museum most of the time. I wanted it to be there and to meet each and every visitor who saw the museum, because I needed this personal contact and this personal relationship. Of course, there's also just the matter of people getting out mainly very depressed, so I needed to comfort them and serve them a glass of strong liquor. It's also a very practical thing, really.
Sorry to be banging on about this, but you were talking about public space, you were talking about kind of intimate space, and you are actually saying it's in these new kind of public spaces, these non-spaces, it's very hard to establish any kind of real relationship. I think a festival is a perfect place which can do that, where people can meet, can have a discussion, and so forth. So I have high hopes for the cultural arena as an alternative for these Gardenaud kind of spaces, which are totally anonymous, where people can come together and have some
Absolutely.
Meaningful kind of...
I was thinking actually, sorry I interrupted, because I was thinking this Renaissance happened in Italy some hundred years ago. And I was thinking, if there's ever a Renaissance happening, it won't be in America now, certainly not North American. And I think China is still a long way to go because it's a monophone country, yeah. So Asian is a very monophone place. Mm-hmm. And it's Europe, you know. It's if there's a second Renaissance, it's here, really, because it's now it's so being squeezed and mixed and being provoked, completely provoked. And in a way, it's great to make narrative here as artists, you know, where we're basically the dealer of the storytelling. And every day you do find so many stories here, which is very different than other continent.
Yeah. Okay, that's a very exciting idea, the second Renaissance. So somebody from the audience, maybe one of the programmers even, who think, well, I actually found the second Renaissance in the film, in the film program. Yeah, but it's an interesting idea to explore. Why not? I mean, it's let's see if there's somebody, or maybe people see the opposite. Great, Gert-Jan.
Cinema, is this on?
Yeah, it's working, yeah.
Okay. I think the first Renaissance is still going on. and that's, I guess, one of the... We did some major or smaller discoveries making this program. So, and one of the things that you should realize constantly, especially in a film festival, that you don't look for films to illustrate something. The films are there, they illustrate themselves. So they don't tell the story, they are the story. That's still very much the case. So again, it's nice you talk about this EU 29 program and the subject it tackles. But for me, important was that the films in the program are still good films in themselves. So that's and not because they nicely illustrate something else. And I guess that in the rest of the program, very much you can see that European cinema is still very vital. There are still some very good filmmakers going around. That, if I can call one example, is not in the program, but you will understand what I mean. It says Lars von Trier is a filmmaker at the moment working and indeed provoking and telling his stories, and he's an absolute equal to the best European filmmakers we ever had. And I guess so, in that sense, I want to complicate your story of the second Renaissance.
Well, there are people and there are ideas around, is what you say, there is still the vitality which we can maybe build upon. If you feel like you want to join the discussion, please use the microphone, feel free to join us. I would like to go to another paradox that we're discussing. It's in your film, Eva. There's this fascinating comment which is being made. Rutger, you said Europe is this history and no more war, lasting peace. Then it became the market of the free market. We can flow with goods all over Europe. But in your film, somebody says as a quote, "Well, why do we have a free, an open market, but we don't have an open border for citizens?" So goods can flow anywhere we want nowadays, also outside Europe. But citizens, people, are actually something we want to shut off or increasingly.
I mean, like the film also suggests, like we have this, we've created this new category of the criminal, right, which is the migrant. So everything else is fine because we are making money, we're prospering, but when it comes to people movement, it's just not going to fly, right? So, yeah, I mean, this is the biggest problem. And also, you know, there is this thing that we do that people come in the country, we don't allow them to work, we don't allow them to stay, even at least in Cyprus. I mean, there's the cases of people that are actually allowed in the country, they're ridiculous.
Mm-hmm.
And then, you know, something needs to change. I mean, put them in the workforce, make them part of the society. They're not animals. These are people. These are human beings, right?
Interesting. And when it comes to your, I mean, because this whole concept of where do I belong to is also very strongly in your film. I was really struck about people being native from East London, but still didn't feel like they were part of the fabric.
I was thinking maybe the, you know, sometimes that thing, my thinking goes very technical or technical sense, I thought that the whole problem is created by the border control when we come to the immigration problem. Once they can go through the border control in an equal format, then they can gain a social status. But then I thought that's very technical thinking. It's a new thing. The border control is a new thing. We created what last 100 years only. And I think when I think more, it's to do with the social, the whole society change, which we transformed. The Industrial Revolution 300 years ago really radically exaggerated the human history. Because before that, we're agricultural society. So the human, I don't talk about the caveman's history, but before that was really kind of more land-driven, yeah? The whole making is agriculture making. And I think the Industrial Revolution really squeezed, speed up the whole, the social format. And I think it's a fundamental change, you know, from the agricultural society to this new modern industrial society, the plane, the train speed up, the geographic distance, we start with human exchange. And I think that was some thinking in my previous film, which is UFO in Her Eyes, the fiction film. And I think the whole discussion actually is about totalitarianism in my film, but eventually actually come back to because ultimate landscape changed. We don't have any land to belong to. You know, the land used to be there, now it's a taxi company, yeah? So instead of you grow your rice, you become a taxi driver, you know, using buttons or not. And I think that's fundamental kind of, it's like a brain change, the whole renewing of the way of living. If you have 80 years to live, then the complete change of how you function with the land, yeah? We don't link to land nowadays. ID card is a number with certain kind of social status, yeah? Which you belong, which borough you belong. And I think perhaps this is a much deeper change which created the modern alienation, the individual alienated from the society they're supposed to belong to. And the memory stuck in the old time. And we cannot like suddenly change or rewrite our memory. And I guess this is like, you know, come back to, if you want to talk about my film, it's more like perhaps it's a deeper problem, a deeper theme in the work here.
Okay, it's interesting. Thomas, Cielo is about a second renaissance. Gert-Jan says, I see a certain fatality within certain filmmakers very strongly, apart from the themes you don't or you do would like to identify. You do a fast forward and you look back to the European
project. But he's European, so he
so I have a completely different point of view.
But he might doesn't have farm. He should have farm, you know, his family, but maybe. They don't do farm. Sorry, no. The Chinese, we grow on the farm. Sorry.
Yeah, we no longer do, actually. No, but it's intriguing because a lot of the things you say I recognize, but I'm not saying I have a different point of view, but I come from a completely different view of the world, even. I mean, when you look at, for example, the second Renaissance, the last place I thought it would happen was Europe, for example. So that's intriguing. Whereas, of course, I do know there's a lot of things being produced, etc. But for example, if you talk about migration as well, if you talk about this place being a very open space, I have the completely opposite experience. I work in Brussels a lot with hunger strikers. So what they call illegal aliens going on a hunger strike.
Yep.
And I have the completely opposite experience. I deal with people every day who are criminalized, not for having done something wrong, but for being found in the wrong territory. So in this sense, land is really very clearly defined, or at least on a political level, I agree, that we still stick with this old former idea of the nation state and the... But there's been such a huge evolution because, for example, 100 years ago, if you wanted to leave France, you were fined for migrating from France. And these days, we're really in a different world where you get fined when you try to get in. So the history of migration has changed so much. And I don't think it's an open continent at all. I think it's getting tough to get in. But sometimes it's still easy to get in. But what happens with you after you get in, that's a completely different story.
Because there's also the psychological border, right? Because we, in the West, consider everything that's outside of that border as inferior, as, you know, not civilized and so on. So yeah, I mean, I agree with you completely. This is not at all an open, and especially what happens to them afterwards is even worse with the neo-Nazis, with everything that,
yeah,
you know.
Yeah, but what is funny is I spent my summer in China this year for a research, for a project, and I was mainly very shocked, not because it's so different, but I was really shocked by the similarities when it comes to, for example, of course, I mean, there are things which I found to be much more overt when it comes to propaganda and that kind of stuff, but in a sense, I really had this feeling of being in a very similar, different space, which has also a history of being the center of the world for centuries and considering what is outside to be barbarian or, and I found that really intriguing because to me, we really have the same kind of thing in Europe. And it was the first time in my life, for example, that I was thrown out of a bus because I'm white, which was very intriguing because racism, yeah, to me is something that happens to other people and I help them fight against it. And suddenly you become the subject of racism or the object, let's say. And that completely changed my point of view as well. Or I mean, it's not so different, I think. I think in a way we're as closed, only the borders are less tangible, or I agree, they're more psychological as well. But yeah, to me, it wasn't that different.
But also, I mean, another form of racism is class discrimination,
yeah, yeah,
right?
Oh, yeah.
So even, you know, white or different color within Europe itself, Eastern Europe, Western Europe, right,
yeah,
different
definitely
class systems. So yeah,
I mean, yeah, we have. So I mean, we're very classified. I mean, mm-hmm, I mean, we've got the West on top, and then we've got maybe the South, and then the East. And I mean, that those old ideas are still clinging on, are still sticking. And it's, I mean, that's even when I was researching the museum that I built. There is, it's actually a bit of a parody on the EU is currently investing a lot of money in a huge project which is called the House of European History, which will be opened in 2015 in Brussels in the European Quarter, which will mainly be a huge museum about the history of Europe and the success of European integration and harmonization. I visited a similar exhibition in Beijing, come to think of it, which did exactly the same thing as we do in the Parliamentarium and the House of European History, which is explain after an all-devastating war why the EU, or in that case, the Communist Party, was necessary, yeah, to face the challenges of the future. Hmm. So it was, I mean, even the way the propaganda
it's
works
bizarre
was very,
yeah,
similar.
Yeah.
It was very intriguing. I should have seen it before,
yeah,
I built my exhibition. because then I think I would have built an exhibition from a Chinese point of view 60 years in time that looks back on Europe today.
Please
start. Yeah. I'm doing
we'll
it right
now. We'll stay there with you.
this sweeping misconception. It's really the conservatives, or say neo-Nazism, the idea of protecting your own land or your own family business, push away the foreigners because they are foreigners, is such a, it's a result of propaganda. I think that the result of this, I couldn't find a word, but it's they are the victim of the propaganda. Is you think this land is your land, mm-hmm, and you think you're running a business. The other country people, the Chinese or Africans, come to take over your job, and your kids will lose job. It's absolutely a misconception, because what is the fundamental problem is where the power started, and how this power, this multinational corporation power, being constructed. The headquarters, perhaps, maybe in New York, but who are the workers? Workers in Bangladesh or China, and the middle boss may be based in Europe.
Yep.
And you often find that the whole multinational structure layered like this. And if you see that, if this is being presented largely in the media, you become less conservative about this border control, pushing away the foreigners, because that's the structure layout.
Yeah.
You cannot be immune from closing the door to push away others, which means if you push away the others, meaning you push away the future, mm-hmm, for your own child, because he will not find a job in Asian or Africa or Latin American. It's one word nowadays. You know, I think this. I think we intend to blame, you know, the right wing and the conservative, but where this propaganda come from? It's a fear, it's such an inner fear of this small hold on to own land, this, yeah, self-possessed land.
What kind of fear? I mean, it's one of your chapters in your film, the Fear's Invention.
Yes.
How do you relate to what Xialu?
She's saying exactly what
yeah?
I mean, there's nothing else to comment
no
on. It's right on, you know. I mean, we've talked about it already in circles, but yeah, I don't have anything else to add to it.
Okay. Gerben, could I ask you something? One of the other programmers, part of responsible for State of Europe, one of the documents we stayed as a festival, well, of course we can collect 16 films or more in a program, but we're not going to write an answer, but maybe we can find the right question. That's what you wrote down. Could you share a question which popped up during the festival, during your selection, which is intriguing to think of, or where you were surprised yourself by making the selection as you did?
Oh dear.
if
you'd given me a few minutes to prepare.
We're exploring. So
what this Grand Tour does is show you around. Mm-hmm. I can give some answers. I mean, what it does, it didn't make me pessimist about the state of Europe at all. It did not make me utopian or optimist about the future either. Mm-hmm. I think many of the issues that are being dealt with here, racism, class differences, immigration, alienation, mm-hmm. are real and have to be faced. The problem of Europe is there also. At the same time, there are no clear answers. There are just issues. So I'm not pessimist mm-hmm. About the situation. I'm mm-hmm. also not optimist.
Mm. Okay.
Questions? If you give me a few minutes, I'll write a few.
Okay, but we'll come back to one of the questions then
you've been warned.
I'm sorry, but...
No. Because Thomas, if there is... I mean, we're going to wrap up a bit. We're going to have a couple more minutes. If we think of narratives, ideas that we can look for in future work of you or other filmmakers or a festival like this, what are kind of the questions that we should ask ourselves?
Good grief, that's a question I've never asked myself. I said to you that. Good grief, that's the question you prepared. You've been preparing all along. Oh God, I should have known. That's funny because what I usually always tell people, because people come out of the things I create and they often ask me what they should do now or think now, and then I go like, yeah, but that's up to you. I mean, I just, what I try to do or what I create is when I do my research and while I work, mm-hmm. I stumble into a lot of questions myself and things I go like, shit, I didn't know that. Why doesn't anybody know this? Or damn, it works like that. And these questions raise more questions, and I just want to share the questions I have.
Yeah.
I have no clear answers. I have a lot of questions, and the more I learn, the less. I mean, that's a cliche, of course, but the less I know, mm-hmm. and the lesser I seem to know. So I just want to share these questions, and I think it's always up to an audience to take them home and see which questions they want to work on, mm-hmm. and mm-hmm. they want to. So it depends. I mean, I can't generalize. It depends on the work. This time, when it's about the museum, it was really about responsibility and about how does this machine function, and mm-hmm. and about creating not even a question but a feeling, generating a feeling of nostalgia for something that actually still exists, but make you feel the nostalgia you usually feel when something is gone. Mm-hmm. So that's more of a sentiment or something. Of course, with the question, what will we do now? I mean, European elections.
I think I can answer your question a little bit.
Shit. No, I mean, see, but that's always up to other people. That's perfect.
That's
good,
no,
that's
I think what your exhibition does, and I hope this... program we've made does is re-engage you a little bit with the subject. I mean, so many people have been so completely disengaged with Europe.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
They rather skip the whole question and go straight to globalization to make things even more complex. So I think if what your exhibition does did for me is sort of like re-engage with the subject of Europe, and maybe not have the answers. Nobody has the answers.
No.
But to at least feel part of it, and at least want to be part of the solution.
Yeah.
I think this is a very good point, because you said a feeling, right? And I was having a discussion last night that there has to be some kind of a feeling generated by the work, right? Some kind of a thought process, a self-reflexibility, right? Mm-hmm. Reflexiveness or whatever. Something that transforms you as the viewer to mm-hmm. make you...
Yeah.
question and how do I think about things? Yes. Like you said, they're asking you, what should I think, right? Yes. So I think this is the most important, and this is, I think, what drives all of us.
All good art does, basically.
Right. Right.
Yeah, and I think if because it's I completely agree, and if that's the effect, I'm very happy. But it's not my initial purpose when I start creating something. Okay. It's not my purpose to say I want the viewer, for example, to re-engage in Europe, because then I just mainly be creating, well, political propaganda in a way. It's I think it's more complex. But that's one of the things where it ends up. I mean, I
what's wrong with political propaganda?
No, it's I mean often
you don't want to go there.
Charlie, what's wrong with political propaganda?
Absolutely.
No, but in a way, of course, I have my own purposes, and if you leave the museum, I hope you don't have the feeling, oh, now with the upcoming elections I will have to vote for that party and all the four things to turn right again. that's of course not the kind of propaganda it is. But of course you want to re-engage. I mean, but to me, even the question we have to re-engage in Europe is a very strange thing, because I keep asking myself, why do we have to re-engage in Europe? I mean, this is the entire European project is something we created, we wanted to have, we put it there, we vote for it, we vote for the friggin' politicians who work in the European Parliament on a national level, and they're in the European, I mean, the Council of Ministers every month, although they pretend they're not. But we created this thing, so why do we disengage and want to re-engage again and pretend it's some kind of abstract monster governing our lives above our heads? I mean, it's not. It's an entity we have created, so we should regain.
Well, it's funny. I think also this is where it fits with what Rutger mentioned in the beginning. Like we are ourselves, so why don't we have as a cultural field or as a festival or as artists and filmmakers play this role within this engagement? Which is maybe something nice for another guest we have in the audience here, Masha Iwe from the European Cultural Foundation. I think that's a very interesting approach, which fits with what you have been doing with a manifest on how culture and culture practitioners can engage themselves more strongly. So maybe your input is now.
We've never met, but now we meet. Hello, Masha from the European Cultural Foundation. And I'm extremely happy also to hear you all speaking, because it's exactly when we saw what the focus of this year's festival would be, we were extremely excited, because it's also, I think you put it in the newspaper of the festival, like there are so many stories out there. And sorry, I'm maybe not pronouncing your name. Xiaolu Guo.
Thank you.
Also speaking about the richness of all these stories which are going around in Europe. And you also said we sometimes miss also a link to the institutional, right? I wish that there would be many more politicians, for example, sitting here.
Absolutely.
And listening to you.
It's taped, we're sending it.
That's good.
Why they always no time? They never have time.
So I'm going to make a really bad translation. This manifesto is called, because we're doing it now, because we're here in the Netherlands at the moment, and you have the elections coming up, and we want the Dutch politicians at least to be much more listening and being connected also to the cultural field. And we try with this manifesto to do some kind of steps, and we linked up with many other organizations in the Netherlands and also with the International Film Festival here. And what we really want to do is making those bridges. And I'm not going to take too much of your time, but I think these stories, and also Thomas, I visited the exhibition, and I didn't see your film yet, but I want to see your film.
Later.
And this is, you know, what should happen. You should become really curious about these things, which are all our matter. It's not somebody out there doing things. It's our lives, it's our societies. And this is where this manifesto also stands for. So we have to choose, because we're working with politicians, three fields, and it's talent development, which is very close to also giving, for example, filmmakers much more space. Therefore, you need good policies, because you're working in Europe. So we want to also make this link from both sides, from grassroots people making beautiful things, having the stories, and being much more heard in the political arena, but also the other way around. Okay, what kind of policies do we all need, and how can we shape them? So what's our own responsibility, and how do we turn around things?
Yeah.
So it's talent development, it's open democracies, and it's innovation and entrepreneurship we choose, because you have to offer politicians concrete things. And that's what our job we're trying to do. We try to make the cultural field enthusiastic, have them as partners, and also try to get into media. For example, your story should be in the media, and then politicians who read newspapers get also aware of, hey, there are elections coming up, and maybe it's also true, time to think differently. And there was one beautiful example one of our partners gave, Nelly Kroes, who's the Euro Commissioner. She's responsible for the digital agenda. And she actually invited, I think, one of the first people ever did that, artists and cultural operators in those reflection groups to think about these issues, which are very much related to cultural workers, the digital, the data, and so forth.
Okay.
So I think this is my contribution, and wonderful. Thank you for sharing all your beautiful stories.
Well, and it's interesting because, Ritra, I mean, it's also when it comes to this platform, when it comes to well, finding the right platforms, building these bridges is also something that I think which has been in the heart is what the idea was of the program and how it's maybe even worked out.
I think so.
Yeah.
Sure. Can we have a? Will you allow us to have like 1 minute of fun and we can fantasize a little bit? we go to the science fiction part of the discussion.
Okay.
Because I'm totally inspired by Xiaolu saying, Europe will be the place for the second Renaissance. How will this Renaissance look like?
I mean, I've been leading some kind of discussion about what's the next power. Of course, everyone says Chinese power. So it was very big discussion in Jaipur Literature Festival last week, and I was basically on this opening session. Everyone says China will be the power, but again, I think the cultural power was never presented from the East. It was second layer, kind of second rate stuff, because the power nowadays is money power, economical power. Instead of we speaking European language, let's say I speak English language now, in order to communicate, and as the literature, cinema, the art world comes very far, far away, takes some years for the culture to merge. So in essence, I think in Europe, everything is really on the table. The culture is very easily presented, being understood than other continents, say America. It's less so, I think, fast digested. So I think we should have some hope, but then it's easily said, how we deal with the border problem. Like me, even I wait for 5 years to get my legal status in order to live here. So it's absolutely a complex city.
Eva, what does your second Renaissance look like?
I really like this idea as well. I think we have to just study this identity issue, right? And I mean, you're talking about United States also. I mean, I was waiting 13 years to get my papers there, right? My family in Cyprus is waiting for 20 years to get their papers there. So this is a very, interesting. But I think, again, getting rid of this fear of this disappearance as an identity, or where I belong, what I am, and just being open and creating a more pluriversal world. Mm. I think this is
okay. Okay.
My utopia.
Thomas?
Oh, God. Well, I think, I mean, I agree with both of you, so I'll start. that's my utopia right there.
Yeah.
You are my utopia. No, the only thing I was just thinking while you're saying that is, I mean, I agree. The only thing I hope, or my hopes for the future, are that these kinds of discussions, it's easy to say, but will take place in other spaces as well, because I was immediately thinking of my family, for example, who never had to wait for a visa, because they're white and very Flemish. That's a different story altogether. So I hope that we have some new issue, well, very old issues coming back in Flanders as well, for example. I hope this discussion will end up over there, for example, because we can talk about fear and nationalism and identity, and these are discussions that have been raging for ages, but somehow they haven't ended up in the farms yet, or some parts of the city where I hope people will talk about fear, for example. I know a lot of people who live in fear but don't talk about fear, for example.
I think this is very important to get the work out there. I don't know how it is in Europe so much, but in the States, it's very much the responsibility of the filmmaker to engage these discussions and things. So that's a good point.
Oh, and you have to answer your own question,
as
a wrap-up for this a beautiful search for the state of Europe. Rutger.
I'm going to go on a limb here. I'm not sure if it's the latest hipster thing or whether there's something true in it.
Yeah.
But and you've been talking about it as well, I know. it seems to me that a lot of people are like small is the new big. Mm-hmm. A lot of people are angry with Europe, all the big institutions, all the economical powers they cannot relate to. So they give up. They start their little own farm. Basically, they start their own initiative. They start their own company. They start their own without the banks, without not a part of this these old systems. And again, I don't know if it's the latest hipster thing, but I think it's really interesting that people are at least trying to figure out like what their personal perfect little spot would look like. Yeah. And even John Wall is buying into it with this latest Utopia series.
And so making so it big.
If he's on it, it might be true.
Okay. Well, I think that's a perfect ending of an hour searching for the state of Europe, our little odyssey. Thank you for sharing your ideas, for Rutger thinking of this platform.
Thank you,
programmers, for making this beautiful State of Europe program, Yevgeny, Gert-Jan, and Gerwin. And well, good luck with everything, and have a great festival for the last couple of days. Thank you for being here. Thank you.